Shalom, Rastafari. This is Wendell Malanzo of the Line of Judah Society. Now, we're going forward to Torah portion number 17, our Rastafari Senbet Shabbat study number 17, Be'amarinya, which is titled in Amharic, Yotor. Hebrew language titled Yithro, and in English we have Jethro. Okay, Rastafari house study number 17, Yotor, Jethro. You know, very significant for many different reasons. We've gone over the New Testament Adis Kidan portion of the reading, and how blessed be the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom, and how that directly connects to Psalm 72, which is a description of the kingdom, universally accepted by those that say that they are. We refer to the Jews, and so Psalm 72, a clear connection to Ethiopia, for Ethiopia shall posture before him, and his enemy shall lick the dust. Okay, you know, this is a humbling moment, because we forgot completely, like, exactly how it reads. You know, even after studying this over and over and over, but still, they that dwell in the wilderness shall bow before him, and his enemies shall lick the dust. Ethiopians shall bow before him. And so, with that, we'd like to make another connection, which is quite obvious. Except the rest of the world has failed to make note of it. You know, both Jew and Gentile and Christian and all peoples, except for Rastafari, who do testify those things we do see and know. So now, in the beginning of Psalm 72, which is concerning Solomon, we the first verse reads, "Give the king thy judgments, O God, and thy righteousness to the king's son." So this is the main focus, the topic for this here reasoning. We have a king to whom belongeth judgment, and we have the king's son to whom righteousness is attributed. Now, a lot of people can't even begin to contemplate or meditate just ponder the idea, think the idea that His Majesty is the manifestation of the Word in these latter days as God the Father, you know, bringing to I and I people Christ in glory, you know, so Christ in His kingly character, His Imperial Majesty, Haile, Selassie first, you know. The world cannot really even begin to comprehend that. We think this is an opinion for the simple fact that the world and all religions that hold true to the Bible or accept the Bible, they fail to make a clear and obvious distinction between one to whom judgments are given, which is the king, and that other to which righteousness is attributed, which is manifested in form of the king's son. So now, we're going to go forward and make that connection and bring forth scriptures and discern them properly, correctly, and just to make known to the world how it's pretty obvious that there's a difference. So, God the Father and God the Son, and so on and so forth with that thought, with that meditation. And now it's even more very credible that it all ties in into Yotor, into the study Torah studies or readings, Yotor Jethro, which happens to be the father of an Ethiopian, Zipporah, whom married Moses and bare him two children, Gershom and Eleazar. So now, we've gone over the New Testament readings. Now, within the prophets, the readings, the portion of reading attributed to Rastafari Senbet Shabbat study number 17, Yithro, is actually Isaiah from chapter 6, and we're going to go forward to that. It is Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, on to chapter 7, verse 6. And, so now, there's another, small portion of reading within the prophet study that we hold within Rastafari Senbet Shabbat study number 17, titled Yotor Yithro Jethro, father of the Ethiopian wife of Moses, Zipporah, which bore him two children. Now, that next portion or reading is chapter 9, verse 5. To chapter 9, verse 6. So now, also within the book of the prophet Isaiah. So what that reads is, for every battle of the warrior is with confused noise. The garments rolled in blood, but this shall be the burning and fuel of fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Now, a lot of people might just automatically assume, jump to the irrational, illogical conclusion that this speaks of one Geta, Jesus Christos, our Lord, or Geta, Jesus Christos, you know, our Lord, our Master, Jesus the Christ. But it's clearly not at all describing the things to come that pertain to the Son. This is pertaining to the Son. See, let us go over. This is the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 5. And these two verses, verse 5 and verse 6, are within the Shabbat study number 17, titled Yithro. Jethro. So now, we just have to keep mentioning that because of its, because of the obvious significance. Now, for every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood, but this shall be with burning and fuel of fire. So now, if we were to go forward to Psalm 72, which we have already done and will do so once more until this world becomes acceptant to the truth and the facts that cannot be discredited or abandoned or destroyed, for they are established since the foundations of the world. And so verse 1 of Psalm 72 concerning Solomon, a psalm which is universally accepted by those that say they are and are not, to be a description of the kingdom. Give the king thy judgments, O God. So to whom have the judgments been given to the king? And thy righteousness to the king's son. So this verse, verse 5 of chapter 9 of the book of the prophet Isaiah, it is describing confrontation and vengeance, and it is describing a judgment, not righteousness. So this is clearly attributed a prophecy concerning God the Father, which is to come and bring judgment to this earth, judging righteous judgment. In righteousness doth he make war. And this is speaking of his imperial Majesty. This cannot be attributed or this cannot be thought to be speaking of the Son, to whom righteousness is given. this is not a description of God the Son, yes, as the Christ. This is, in fact, speaking of God the Father in glory, King Christ in his kingly character, his imperial majesty, the mighty Trinity. So now, going forward, even verse 6 is just a tad bit more revealing. Now, verse 6 reads, "For to us a child is born, Yij Tefer, a child is born." 1892, Ethiopia. To us, a son is given, Yitach in Jesus Christos. His imperial majesty, that child born, and to us, and his son, Jesus Christos, a son is given. For to us, a child is born, later to be made titled or christened Rastafari, Rastafari, and in Jah time, crowned and anointed King of Kings of Ethiopia, conquering Lion of the Tribe of Judah, elect of God, the mighty Trinity, His Imperial Majesty, you know, the first. So now, going forward, "And the government shall be upon his shoulder." No, in no place are we ever even so much as hinted that such a government, or any government for that matter, lay upon the shoulders of Yitach and Jesus Christos, our Lord Jesus Christos. Not at all. Contrary to that, the complete opposite. Jesus himself said, "I'm gonna take off. Because, you know, these will want to make me king." You know, so he ran to the mountains himself alone. For he knew that they would, the multitudes would want to crown him king, would want to give him that kingship. But yes, is fulfilling rightfully and fully filling the scriptures, knew better and departed from the multitudes before, to prevent that from even coming to pass. And so, the only thing laid on Jesus' shoulder is the cross, the burden of sacrifice. And no government ever was allotted to Jesus Christos. I mean, that's a simple fact. So this cannot be speaking of Jesus the Christ. This is the only true interpretation and manifestation of this is God the Father in glory, Christ in his kingly character, his imperial majesty, Haile Selassie I, King of Kings of Ethiopia. And so now going forward, "shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called the Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." In no time ever have these titles been attributed to Jesus Christos. He was wanted. Individuals were after him. He was hated. He was persecuted, insulted, you know, or at least ones attempted to do so. Ones would oftentimes attempt to offend him. At times, seek to capture him. At times, seek to stone him. These titles only belong to him that be who he be, his imperial majesty, counselor to this world, wonderful in many ways. Once again, his imperial majesty, at the head of the late breaking news, you know, this would be oftentimes mentioned right before the wonderful late breaking and new event that his majesty would take part in. Wonderful to the world. Counseled us all, you know, the mighty God, the mighty Trinity. Only Him is the living God whom we have known. Now the everlasting Father. The fathership was far from Jesus Christus, because that is not His role and responsibility. He Himself prayed to the Father, called upon the Father, spoke and testified of the Father. This cannot be attributed to him, the Prince of Peace. So now, and that, you know, we ourselves personally took no part in adding this to the Torah portion studies that happens to be titled Yotor, Yithro, Jethro. You know, everything about this is connected and linked clearly to Ethiopia, without a doubt, and to His Majesty. And but before we even and we don't seek to go to that extent. We're going to focus on, okay, so now let us bring more abundant evidence of on how this is not only found in these evidences are not only found in these few verses, but in plenty, in a variety of different situations. So now, because of the fact that we already are within the book of the prophet Isaiah, we're going to go forward to Isaiah chapter 7, verse 10. And it reads, Moreover, the Lord spake again to Ahaz, saying, Ask thee a sign of the Lord thy God. Ask it either in the depth or in the height above. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. And he said, Hear ye now, O house of David. It is a small thing for you to worry men, but will ye worry my God also? Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. So now, God with us. But what we're trying to point out here is that this right here is speaking, prophesying of the Christ the essence to come. This chapter 7, verse 14, that sign of that a virgin shall conceive, that is within the power of the Son, Jesus, the Christ. Not chapter 9, which is a divine child, Israel's only hope. Chapter 9, verse 5 and 6, which we just reasoned upon. So now, going forward, butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. So now, there's actually a footnote, and if we didn't mention this, we'll go ahead and do so. We are reading from the Old Schofield Study Bible, and there's a footnote alongside butter. And so, let's go forward to that. And it reads here, indicating the plainness and simplicity of the life in which the young Emmanuel should be brought up. Not only, I mean, that actually does apply to His Majesty, because at a young age, even though he was royalty, he was kind of separated, and he grew up and lived a normal life, so that he would not be spoiled with the riches at too young of an age, without the knowledge and without the knowledge and wisdom to maintain that responsibility that comes with royalty. So this could be attributed to His Majesty, but this is this is describing Jesus the Christ. And so, let's read, indicating the plainness and simplicity of the life in which the young Emmanuel should be brought up. So this is, His Imperial Majesty was, what we said is accurate, but now that we think about it, it comes to mind that at the age of only 13, he was already... Excuse me if that's not all that correct, but, let's help each other kind of get those facts straight. We should know this, but at the age of 13, His Imperial Majesty, well, at that time, at the age of only 13, was given the responsibility as Ras. And so double check if it's actually at the age of 13, because some studies indicate slightly different dates, and actually we haven't studied this in a long time, so double check that. But at a very young age, is what we're trying to say. His Imperial Majesty already took very, very hard responsibilities, you know, especially for a man of his age, well, a child coming into manhood, adulthood, you know. And so nonetheless, going forward, we'll go forward to to the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 11, verse 1. And it reads, it's titled, "The Davidic Kingdom Set Up, the King's Ancestry." So now, "And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots." So now, this is not talking about one individual, one character. This is actually another clear evidence of how this is speaking about two separate persons. Same spirit. "And there shall come forth," what shall come forth? "A rod." So righteousness, that rod of righteousness, which is, yes, is the Christ, shall come out, come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. So now the stem of Jesse is a trunk, a cut off trunk. You know, so out of that circumcision, born of the spirit, yes, is, does come forth out of, you know. So yes, that like in the flesh, a descendant, or you know, in within the family of Jesse, but sprang out of the root of this. Okay, we kind of lost track with that. A little bit.